like this. Let me work, show me where the mic is. I'm on stage, black shirt and my Tims. You know how I do it, I ain't playing with you. I've been grinding. Anybody trying to sleep on me, better do something with your eyelids. I hear a lot of whining, but I don't hear a lot of rhyming. Whoa! Everybody got opinions, let it go into my ear, then I block that.
Welcome into the Afternoon Sports Drive. Stop that phony. Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler and Jason Elmquist with you here on Thursday. So we are getting close to wrapping up June, believe it or not. Jason, are you a summer guy? You like summer?
No.
I don't either. I really don't. And people think I'm crazy when I say that. It's like, why? Everyone lives for summer, especially in the Midwest. I'm like, it's disgustingly hot.
Yeah.
There's not a lot of sports going on.
Well, and that's the thing for people who are in the sports field, sports media and stuff like that. Like, summer's the only time you can take vacation as well.
Right.
Like, literally the only time. And again, it's so hot and miserable most places you want to go. I've never been a big fan and again, when you're trying to also fill up, a sports section, you know, crazy enough, in previous summers, like, we've been almost desperate trying to come up with content to help fill the news press. And this year, even despite a pandemic and everything going on, we've gotten through the end of June with really no concerns when it comes to actually coming up with story content.
Yeah, I think
it's been very weird.
That's kind of been what's surprising, though, to a lot of people, especially with guys like us in our field. So we haven't really had a shortage of things to talk about. I mean, especially at Oklahoma State.
Right, right.
But that's kind of like an outlier situation.
Yeah.
But I mean, sports in general, we've been able to kind of fill up shows pretty easily for the most part. And I think that's the same for a lot of media writers and things too.
Yeah, because I mean, you go back to May, you know, in May we were looking at, you know, I tweeted it out back in the middle of May, some of the things that were supposed to be going on, you know, especially here in Stillwater. You know, obviously the annual Special Olympics, but you had the tennis national championships were supposed to be here. Obviously, the Big 12 baseball tournament down the road, the Big 12 softball tournament down the road in Oklahoma City. Both softball and baseball for OSU were likely going to host regionals. And maybe, you know, if they finish high enough, could have been super regional candidates as well. And, you know, that would have filled up all of May. And then maybe if both or one of them made a run, that would fill up the first half of June like it did last year. And we didn't get any of that, but we're still here at the end of June. And we never really have had a especially over the past month, we haven't necessarily had a down period of, man, what are we going to talk about? It's nothing but national news going on. It's like, well, we've actually gotten, you know, for good or bad, we've gotten a lot of stuff to talk about over the past month.
Yeah, there's definitely been plenty of news everywhere, so that hasn't been an issue.
Oh, and we even have news today.
We do. We have a lot of news that we're going to get to. We'll talk about, they've officially released the date for the Yeti film. And you know what? It's earlier than I thought. I think when we had Chris and Dave on the other day, they said
sooner rather than later.
Sooner rather than later.
Because they had a 3-month window.
Yeah. And they expected starting in July, though.
Yeah.
And when in fact it will be coming in June 29th,
Monday.
Which is Monday. That's 4 days away.
Monday, 8 o'clock.
8 o'clock.
Time, yep.
And then the Big Country film also will be airing on July 1st, I believe that is
what
I saw.
Was the first, that Wednesday?
Yeah.
Okay.
So,
I couldn't read it fast enough to figure out if it was that Wednesday or the Wednesday after that they were going to be doing that as well.
Yeah, so you've got an Oklahoma State loaded couple of nights there on ESPN. Let me double check here. July 1st at 6 p.m. Central Time for the Finding Big Country film. Which is also, I've heard, is really good. I watched the first like teaser.
I believe Woodruff's in that.
Yes,
one.
Yes, he is. Yeah, no, he already came in and told
I know
me
his
that.
Dad is. I knew his dad was, and I know he did some interviews. I didn't know because I haven't seen it yet. I think you can actually watch it on YouTube when they first released it. Mm-hmm. But I knew Woodruff had done interviews and helped that documentary kind of get in touch with the Big Country. But I didn't know if he actually got cut scenes in there.
Yeah, he's going to be on ESPN, so he may be out of here actually on his new career. And who knows what else.
And Tom on Monday? I mean,
yeah. We might be losing everybody.
Yeah.
You and I didn't get a chance, so it may just be us around here. But get some guys getting some ESPN time. So that is July 1st at 6 o'clock. And then again, the Yeti film will air June 29th 8 o'clock Central time here with everybody around this area can watch it. I watched the first teaser trailer that was released.
Pretty.
And yeah, it was fantastic. I mean, that 30 seconds alone will give you chills. It shows you some of the biggest names that could possibly be interviewed with all of this. Yeah. Bill Self, Bill Clinton, Jerry Jones.
And Calipari.
Calipari, yeah, it goes on and on. Yeah. And that's what was great, too, when Chris said he talked to ESPN. They're like, how did you get some of these names come in?
Yeah.
So that's pretty impressive. The score was fantastic in those 30 seconds. That's one of the things I love the most about documentaries, too, is the scores that come out of it. That's going to be great. There some of the reviews. One was on there from Dick Vitale, how good it was. Myron Metcalf saying it was one of the best sports documentaries he's ever seen.
Skip Bayless was quoted in it as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Again, it might have been Skip or maybe one of the other quotes talking about how the brothers essentially kind of made the whole thing.
Yeah, talking about how Sean and Rex Chapman to put that in there as such a raw emotional style to the documentary. And I think that's half of it is that we all know the success of Eddie, but there were a lot of little things that weren't so great. Yeah. We all know that, too, but it's documented and told from firsthand experiences. Let's go to the phone line. You're on the Afternoon Sports Drive. Go ahead.
Hey, sorry to pull y'all off topic, but I should have asked this to Larry, but I'm still a little worked up over the Pete Thamel article. Jason, do you know, does Holder still donate his salary back to the athletic department?
I do not know that. I'm not 100% certain.
I know he did it for some time, and I don't know if that's still his practice. But, he was called out pretty good for his $950,000 salary and the financial part of that. And if there's anything I'm confident about is Mike Holder's not going to let anybody take the financial burden unevenly in the athletic department. I think he'll probably ask for more concessions than anybody else would around the country as an athletic director. So anyway, I just felt like I needed to protect Holder or say that on the air.
Yeah, no, I think we even Tom mentioned, and I know AP back in when the pandemic first started had Holder quoted basically saying, that we'll find any way possible for our spring athletes, seniors that want to come back. We're gonna make a way. We're gonna find the money to be able to support whoever wants to come back. So obviously, he was thinking about the students even back then, more so than the money. How am I gonna fit all of these guys in here? It was we're gonna figure out a way, one way or another.
Yeah, I think so. But anyway, I wanted to kind of throw that out if somebody had read that and forgotten Mike Holder and how he's. I know he worked for free for a few years, and assume he probably still does.
No, yeah, I didn't even know that had happened at one point, if it still is. I did not know that.
Well, check that out to make sure I'm right. But I'm just sure Holder donated his salary back to the athletic department.
Okay.
Yeah, thanks for your call. Appreciate it. Yeah, so I had heard that earlier today as well. I think someone called into Robert's show and maybe said that. And I hadn't been able to confirm or deny that either. But, I mean, from people that are talking about Mike Holder, would they really be surprised? Probably not. So he's – and it's funny that you mentioned that, telling everyone, well, he was always here for the – doing whatever they can for the spring athletes and all that to make sure they have a chance to come back. It's kind of the opposite of, we have to remember how lucky, for instance, those athletes are to have something like this happen and not be in the same shoes as, for instance, Wisconsin athletes when Barry Alvarez did the exact opposite and told them to go. So.
Yeah. Oh, and, again, I think – Because again, we haven't heard anything from OSU on coaches taking pay cuts and stuff like that. And again, the only thing when it came to that was Gundy saying, I don't want to even broach that subject right now. And again, that was back in early April. We haven't heard anything since from anybody. But I think the fact that you were seeing other universities within the Big 12 that were, you know, making those announcements, going through with those cuts. Heck, you even heard it within the Big 12 conference offices were also, everyone was taking a 10% pay cut across the board to help things out. And then, so again, like if you're a player and you know that you're losing your summer stipend and you haven't heard anything about your coach or any other coaches at OSU aside from what your main coach saying that he doesn't want to talk about pay cuts right now, again, I can understand, you know, and I don't know who Beth Ann will talk to or whatever, but I can believe that being the thought process of possibly one or more players if they saw it that way.
Yeah, I can understand frustrations easily.
Right.
I mean, that's definitely something I would want answered too. But especially when you see a bunch of other schools, like you said, in the Big 12, around the country, that were pretty transparent through this whole process. I think that that's something Oklahoma State lacked, if I'm being completely honest. Don't think there was a ton of great communication, especially at the height of this. Because I understand it was a big, confusing time for a lot of people at that school, too. They didn't really know what was going on. But still, you do owe it to a lot of people, and let's be honest, student-athletes and personnel and people that support Oklahoma State, to tell them what's the deal with everything.
Well, and we also have to keep in mind while we're talking about that, according to the story, which, again, if they were able to get access to the contracts and, you know, have lawyers look through them and maybe have a little more understanding of those things, but it mentions that it was tough essentially for Holder or the administration to possibly say, hey, we're going to do coaches are going to take pay cuts because some of the structure of these deals supposedly didn't allow such a thing. And then that kind of goes back to the why as an administrator didn't you prepare for this as a possibility? Because I mean, that's, again, you don't think, oh, a pandemic's gonna happen, but, you know, if you think that something could happen, especially in Oklahoma when you rely so much on oil and natural gas to bolster your economy, and it's already been kind of dwindling over the past few years, even before this pandemic. Yeah, I mean, if that is something that's in the contract, then you have to, I think, from that regard, you have to question the administration of how could you put something in there that doesn't save you in case you needed to do something like that.
Yeah, this was, we know, a completely unprecedented situation, but at the same time, you also have to be ready for pretty much everything.
Yeah, and just to kind of follow up on the question that was from the caller, I asked Tom if he knew if Holder was still doing the return of the earnings. Tom says did initially. He said he doesn't know if he still does.
Okay. So it definitely did at one time.
At one point, but it sounds like nobody right now is 100% certain if he's still doing that, but he did at some point.
Which was, and I saw that too, just south of a $1 million total there, so. Those were the numbers. I think that if anyone reads through that entire Yahoo story, they're going to get the sense of what it was about. I mean, it was about a lot of players clearly were upset with everything that happened and bringing Mike Gundy into the fold as well about him not taking a cut.
And that's the thing, is like from reading that, is it feels like it's mostly Gundy. It's not necessarily a systematic issue. It's not, okay, you know, was the Clemson assistant coach who was accused of using the N-word. Like, we haven't heard anything of that from assistant coaches or whatever. It, you know, whether it's the story or comments that have been made, via Twitter and stuff like that, is it seems like it was kind of Gundy and maybe even policies that Gundy implemented that they're wanting to see change from.
Yeah.
So I think, and again, good or bad, I think that's at least a positive thing, because it's not necessarily, from what I'm reading, a full issue with the program. It maybe it's just, hey, Mike Gundy needs to wake up to the reality that he is coaching a bunch, as he would call, snowflakes, and they're now, those snowflakes have turned into a snowman and they're revolting.
That's a good way to put it. I wouldn't mind a little snow right about now.
Yeah,
it is nuts hot. Oklahoma State, we announced it yesterday, but just to reiterate, also been in the sports report, that they did officially launch the Council for Diversity and Inclusion, chaired by Dr. Jason Kirksey, who is the vice president for that institutional diversity and chief diversity officer at OSU. So, and that's the thing, too. I read about how much recognition and the awards that they've received for that in the past. is pretty impressive. And so this board, this council, will include a student athletes, current and alumni, and then you'll get some members from the OSU athletics, as well as some members just on campus as well from a cross section.
Real quick, some more OSU news. Jeff Goodman reported about an hour ago the location for which Hedy Rusink will be transferring to. A place that both of us would recognize, right up the road. He's going to UMKC.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's going to be a Roo.
Yeah. He's going to play in some Division II.
I think they're technically Division I.
Is UMKC Division I in basketball?
Yes.
Okay. They might.
They're
be.
Just. I mean, they're like they're below mid-major.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like they're way down there. I'm pretty sure they've been D1 for a couple years
okay.
now.
Okay. It was pretty recent then. I need to double check that because I remember UMKC would play Missouri Southern occasionally. In basketball,
yes,
back when I went there.
According to Wikipedia, they are D1.
D1. Does it say for how long that's happened?
That I could probably search through Wikipedia to find out when exactly.
So UMKC.
Well, they made their Division I postseason first appearance in 2017 in the CBI. But as far as when they actually... Yeah, it doesn't say when they actually... became a D1, but they've never played in the national or the NCAA tournament.
Right.
So.
Okay. Well, he's heading down there, and you know what? Pretty decent basketball program too. I mean, sports overall, UMKC has been pretty solid. That he is one of two that have left Oklahoma State. That has been the biggest story, I think, since the news of the punishment was. Well, we actually held on to a majority of what a lot of people thought would not be here, and I definitely was one of them, at least for some guys. The interesting part about all that now, and I kind of brought it up, I think it was yesterday even, was, you know, looking down the road at OSU basketball, if they get this, let's say they push this back farther, the appeal far enough to where they're able to get in the season and then basically get in a full season and might even find their way into the postseason. If that's the case and the NCAA finally, and let's say a federal court rules on it and they rule that it's still upheld, then why would they, you know, you're looking towards maybe next year. All of a sudden, it's like we got to put all of our chips on the table this season when we have Cade Cunningham on
the
roster.
Right.
So, and it may be one of those situations where it's like if that's the case, and we got to accept all of a sudden maybe a postseason ban for an Isaac Likely as a senior year.
Yeah, and that's the thing is I think people kind of swept past it and didn't really think through what a comment from Mike Boynton on Monday, but. You know, because it was in, you know, kind of in passing, part of a longer conversation. But, you know, because I originally had asked him about what preparations they're making for athletes coming back, stuff like that. And later on, it was asked about, you know, that fine line that he has to coaches, not just he, but all coaches in college football and college athletics, of making sure that these guys stay healthy, but also don't strip them of their ability to still be college kids. And he made the comment about how, you know, right now going out to the bars and going out to parties is not the best thing. But he ended up, after that, he made the comment of, because we want to be able to play basketball at some point this winter. That phrase made me think that maybe there are conversations of, do we actually start the basketball season at the beginning of November, or do we wait until January and just go straight into conference? Like the way he worded that is of, at some point, hoping to play basketball this winter. Again, maybe I'm sure he's hopeful that you start the season, but it makes me wonder if there is conversations being had, because I did see, because remember we talked about how John Smith told me that for wrestling at D1, they're wanting to possibly start in January this year, and then, hopefully down the road, eventually move it into a spring sport. Well, at the junior college level, they announced earlier this week for the junior college wrestling rankings. So, again, it's totally different from Division I and stuff like that. But, we're starting to see a lot of athletic organizations for college thinking about what do we do with winter sports. And I'm going to be curious at what point Division I starts taking that into account as well.
I think they definitely have to be thinking about it now. When we talked about the possibility of that even happening at football at some point, and I even expressed that I didn't think it was thought about enough. I know there had been a lot of tweaking, but with basketball kind of getting a chance to look at it now, bottom line for them is they can't miss the NCAA tournament 2 years in a row.
Yeah.
They just can't.
Yeah.
That is way too much money. So if they can push it up a little bit, yeah, and then maybe it works out. If it's a big enough threat for a second wave, where they keep talking about it, that's such a possibility, then something's got to be
done. Oh, that's why I think they consider, you know, possibly doing a conference only season for basketball, because then you don't start until January effectively. You know, that kind of keeps you two months away from if there is a spike, but then hopefully by then you can get back to some sign of normalcy before March Madness. You know, obviously it would be unfortunate because as you know we've talked with other, like with baseball, I mean, how many teams actually need that non-conference, because that's where they find their identity before going into conference play. And you know you go back to, I've said it over the years, a program like Kansas with Bill Self, there's times where, you know, they look shaky in the non-conference.
Oh, yeah.
And they go out there and they still end up winning the Big 12. So that's that'll be the difficult thing, is if that's a route they decide to take with college basketball, is we're going to find out, just like we will for Major League Baseball, if you can find out the identity of your team before it's too late, because of how limited they could potentially do it if they just do a conference schedule.
And, you know, big blood schools, that the blue bloods that go out there and schedule some of these non-conference games even on the road too, that's where you see and especially a younger team, you see a lot of glimpses of either we're ready or we're not ready.
Right.
Because it was the same last year when I see, well, North Carolina was really bad, but when they go in to play an Elon team, for instance, and it's like, oh my gosh, we can't even hang.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where, and you know, Duke, same way with Stephen F. Austin, anything can happen. And the best part about those games is when you start looking into the tournament and the NCAA go, well, we were going to put them at this seed, but remember that loss way back when, yeah, against, you know, this no name.
Now, if again, we're talking in all hypotheticals. We don't know. There's been no conversations. But you know, again, if football gets disrupted, it's more than likely that, you know, basketball would and stuff like that. But if they did something like, hey, we're going to not do a non-conference, just start with conference play, do you think, who benefits most from that? What types of teams? Obviously, I would assume the team that's chocked full of returning starters and veterans, but I mean, they would typically anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But in my mind, I almost feel like an Oklahoma State might also benefit from that, because when you go out game one against, let's say you get Kansas in game one, well, Bill Self doesn't have, you know, 2 months of film on Cade Cunningham,
yeah,
and Moncrief and all these guys. Yeah, you can look at college or high school tape, but they're in a different system. You know, maybe that benefits a program like Oklahoma State, where you're going to have a lot of young players involved.
I think it does. It could go both ways, because there would be a team like Oklahoma State. Let's say that was their first game was a conference game, and there's a lot of expectation. That's a team where we've talked about there could be some growing pains.
Oh, yeah.
You don't want to have growing pains in conference games. You know,
true,
by that
very
time,
true,
you,
yeah,
want to be ready to go. So it could go, it really could go very good or very bad, honestly,
yeah,
for a lot of teams.
Yeah.
When we come back, we'll talk about Oklahoma State a little bit more, as well as the bunch of other Power 5 commissioners, not only the Big 12, but all of the Power 5, planning on having football starting on time, everything starting normally as of now for a lot of them. We'll discuss that also. A picture was finally released in the Bubba Wallace discussion of the rope noose that was hanging in the garage stall. So we'll discuss a little bit more about that. Also to come here on the Afternoon Sports Drive, Tom Dorado in the 4 o'clock hour, Donnie Walton at 4:30. I don't want to wait.
California, running in the streets all day. I get some of it.
the afternoon sports drive here on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler and Jason Elquist with you, 1020, 1580 AM, 93.1, 105.1 FM. Triple Play Sports Radio app. Stream us live anywhere. And I mean anywhere. Power 5 schools, they were polled. There were a bunch of commissioners, ADs, decision makers, as they like to call them. Polled by 247 Sports, and the majority says they're planning on having a football season starting on time, too. I got to admit, also, when I see some quotes from Pac-12 Commissioner Larry Scott, there was a lot of times in the past months where publicly I made it, you know, clear, and a lot of people did. Well, Pac-12, are we really going to have a football season there with everything that was going on in terms of California and all that area? We know there was a lot more cases out that way. There was a lot more restrictions as well. And at that time, it seemed like may not. Who knows when we're going to get back to normal, at least in that area. And then latest we've heard also from Oregon State, and well, they plan on still coming into Stillwater. So same, you know, kind of echoes what Larry Scott said. Said, quote, "I remain cautiously optimistic college football will be played this fall and that we will be able to do so in a manner that prioritizes the health and safety of our student athletes and all those connected to the sport." I think that's basically the way to put it. I mean, yeah. he's saying, you know what, we're planning on not only starting on time, but doing it when we figured out a way to do it in a way that makes sure everyone is protected. And it kind of makes me think, too, because we've seen multiple stories of different players that have been polled or even players that have come out and said, look, I'm willing to play. You know, even if there's not a vaccine or whatever, trust that these guys on the team and medical professionals know what they're talking about. I'm ready to get out there and go play, and whatever happens, happens. I think that's basically kind of the approach. If people look down in the details, they understand what we said all along, that they're going to make college football happen.
Yeah.
I mean, even with some rises in cases, with some people testing positive on teams, if they're able to control it now and find a way to start on August, even if it means no fans, we're going to have college football.
Well, I think Bob Bowlesby's even been quoted saying that, you know, that they're fully anticipating some type of disruption throughout the season. Like, it's you know, and again, that's why you saw the Big 12 ADs taking the initiative of a conversation of possibly moving back the Big 12 turn or the Big 12 title game, just in case you need to possibly shoehorn a game in there the week before. That's going to be the interesting thing is, again, I think, as I've said, we're going to find out basically in about a month from now if we're going through with at least starting the season, because you the NCAA stated that you have to have 4 weeks of practice before you can start your season. So that rolls out to basically August 1. If you aren't having your workouts and whatnot, there's no way for you to start your season on time.
Yeah.
Or again, if you get people in, because we got to keep in mind, not everybody's on campus yet, you know, across the country. We know OU is supposed to be coming in next week, I believe on the first. So that'll be interesting because, you know, we haven't heard, because I don't think I think Clemson is the biggest one that we've heard of having a bunch of players. But, you know, if OU comes back and Alabama comes back and Ohio State comes back and they all suddenly say, we got 20 kids testing positive, then you have to be. That's the thing, is as much as people don't want to hear this, that's also a concern.
Yeah.
Because if it's the big names that are suddenly having these issues, then because it's not, and I'm not saying this just because, well, you know, the favoritism. ESPN wants those people more than they necessarily want Oklahoma State or Oregon State or, you know, these, you know, Kansas on TV. They want OU. They want Alabama. Sure. They want Ohio State. They want Michigan. If those programs are suddenly saying, I don't know if we can start on time, then that, to me, is a bigger concern than, you know, Kansas State right now shutting down or Clemson saying that they've got a bunch. If you have more than just Clemson, then maybe you really start worrying about that possibility.
Well, that's why I think still, to me, it benefits schools like Oklahoma State that are getting players that have had players back for a little while now and are catching positive cases now instead of, like, you know, July 1st when Oklahoma comes back. Well, start testing more, and all of a sudden you're stuck for 2 weeks with some of these guys not being able to be out there. So And that's what Bowlesby has said. You know, it'd be foolish to think that we wouldn't have any positive cases on some of these teams. You're going to have that. And again, you know, people that have asked, because I've heard the question, well, why are so many testing positive all of a sudden? Like, what? Things are open, man. I mean, and it's college towns too. Like, why do you think Clemson had such a big number? I mean, those dudes are out.
Yeah.
They're out of the bars and the parties, just like any other college person would be. Now, whether they, I mean, who am I to judge? But in this situation, would you, if you know, let's say this, if you're a college football player in Clemson University, and you know, like, you're going to be tested a lot, but you're going to be tested pretty quickly here when you come back. Is it a really smart idea to be going out there and partying and stuff and all that and being around large groups of people? Probably not. But at the same time, a part of me understands it too. These are just really weird circumstances.
Yeah.
But hey, if things are going to be open, you can't expect people to not go.
And that's the thing, I think, because again, we're all looking at it from just the football aspect, and you know, because again, and we I understand that drives the money, the economy, and everything. But let's say, for example, Oklahoma State. Let's say they have 10 positive cases. Again, we know for sure three. Let's just say after everyone came in, let's be generous, say went up to 10. Okay, that's only, you know, an eighth of your roster that you're having to sideline or quarantine, and you can probably recover from something like that. Well, if basketball players come in mid-July and 10 of them test positive, that's 90% of your roster. And now you're saying, okay, how are we gonna have a season if, you know, 90% of our guys, you know, we were allowed 13 roster spots and 10 of them are having to be quarantined. That's where the biggest worry is going to be, I think, for athletic directors and for coaches, is these smaller sports where if one or two players come down positive, that derails the season.
Yeah.
Where right now you can be okay kind of with football. Yeah, if it's, you know, one of your studs, obviously that hurts you. But if it's, you know, 10 guys and they're all in the two deep, yeah, we can probably make that work.
Well, glad you brought that up, because I've thought about that before. You know, it's almost as if college basketball players, when it comes around, like, they have to be even more disciplined than football players, really. You know, they want to do the same thing. They want to have a college life, but
which Boynton said on Monday.
He did.
Just mentioned,
he
said, you know, it's not a time to go out to the bars and go to parties right
but,
now.
But that's the thing. Is that going to stop his guys? I mean, it's got to stop guys across the country. No, I don't think it will. Now, there may be some that say, we're going to take this serious. That's great. But they're human beings, too. They're 18 to 22-year-old kids, 21-year-old kids.
Right.
We know what's
going to
happen.
When you get on campus and you get the peer pressure of, hey, we're going out to the bars. Come on, man.
You're a basketball star.
You don't have a game tomorrow. Come on. We can go to the front of the line.
Try to put yourself in the shoes of a basketball star in college.
Yeah.
Like, dude, it's lined up for you, you know? And so that's the thing is, yeah, we want to believe that it's going to be all smooth, but I just don't think it is. The other thing is, too, that's why when you wanted to take it serious, it's now because of the constant testing that they will be undergoing. It's not like it's going to be one test when they come in and they can slide by and get away without being tested. No, this is going to be all the time. Like, we're going to make sure and then test before games and everything like that. And to me, if they came down to that decision and I'm a star player on my team, or even, you know, someone that gets a lot of time, I'm taking it serious just for that, knowing that, hey, I'm going to be tested a lot. So, you know, the chances of, if I get it, are going to be found out pretty quickly here. So, if anything, I think that's going to be the mindset of some of these guys. And who knows? Maybe they'll prove some of us wrong and be extremely disciplined. Should they have to be? No. No one, you know, is asking for this. But it's just, if they want to have a season with minimal interruptions, that might be what has to happen. When we come back, we will get into the NFL situation. I mentioned it yesterday. We didn't get to it. But an article was broke, and I actually got it sent to me by the guy that broke it at the Sports Business Journal. He's a great, great writer. He's going to be on with us next week, I believe. We'll get him out there in a little bit. But the story about basically putting advertisements on instead of people in the seats at some places, and could that affect Jason Elmquist, unfortunately,
yeah,
too?
Yeah, well, and honestly, could, you know, that could be a trickle-down. You might see a trickle-down, because I had talked about, especially at a place like Boone Pickens Stadium, where you have fans right on top of the benches, do you possibly move back those people? And it sounds like NFL is already considering that.
They definitely are, and we'll discuss if it makes sense or not. That's next on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
It's been a too long time with no peace of mind. I'm ready for the times to get better. I've got to tell you, I've been racking my brain.
Welcome back. Wrapping up hour number one here of the afternoon sports drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network. We've got Patrick Wheeler and Jason Elmquist with you. Tom Dorado coming up in the 4 o'clock hour shortly, and then Donnie Walton coming on at 4:30. Give us a ton of baseball talk there, which has been the most popular really going on besides of, well, NASCAR, besides of everything going on in the sports world. Leave it to baseball to find a way to somehow, the way they're going this year, get back, but at the same time botch July 4th. Like, they had an opportunity for such a big weekend there so many times, and this year we're not going to have baseball on July 4th. How un-American does that feel?
And see, this thing, 4th of July is my birthday.
That's right, yeah.
And my
Royals, right? This is what you said, the store you went to the...
Yeah, my 21st birthday, I actually went up to a Royals game with a couple of friends of mine.
Yep.
You know, they had a big fireworks display to music and all that stuff. And it was, I mean, it was Americana.
Yeah.
And... yeah, it's just it's weird. I mean, I haven't, you know, I don't pay a whole lot of attention during the summer for baseball because, you know, that's usually the one time of the year where I can escape sports a little bit because, you know, people don't realize, I always say that end of July when we have OSU or Big 12 football media days, that's the start of the sports season for us.
Sure.
I mean, it's nonstop sports for us from then until whenever, you know, college baseball finishes up. And, you know, a couple years ago, it wasn't until late July or late June when they made it to the College World Series. So there's only about a 2-month window typically. So I don't really follow it a whole lot. But yeah, I mean, that was still growing up. I remember, you know, watching Royals games on my birthday and the fireworks display and all this other stuff. So it's going to be weird. You know, I'm actually going back home for my birthday this year, and it is going to be strange, like, because usually we would the parents would shoot off fireworks and whatnot, and then we'd go in and watch. Actually, I think last year we watched one of the MLS soccer games was the Sporting KC was on, but like unless they have a game for that, like, there's not going to be any sports to watch on the 4th of July, and that's just, you know, and the funny thing is there was always. I remember a friend of mine who's a big baseball fan saying that there's only 2 days of the year in which there are zero sports going on, the day before and the day after the All-Star break.
How true is that, though? Yeah.
And it's weird because that could have technically still been kind of the case this summer, but instead it's no sports going on, period, for a while.
To me, it felt super weird because seeing family on Father's Day and Mother's Day, well, there's always baseball on those days, too. And it's like, what do you do? I mean, you talk to family for a while, then like, okay, now what? You know, it's weird.
Well, I mean, just, you know, looking long term, if this does impact sports going forward, I mean, Thanksgiving weekend, it's football. It's college and NFL football. And that's it.
Yeah, the same with Christmas, putting a game on Christmas Day this year too. Football, NFL,
yeah, and then NBA
and
is
yeah,
dominant then as well.
So,
but
those days, and yeah, I'm glad you brought up Thanksgiving because that, to me, that can't be touched. I mean, come on. It's one thing to miss baseball on July 4th, but missing football on Thanksgiving Day, I don't want to think about it.
Yeah, so that, I mean, again, that's the thing, though, is we also have to, again, I know people look at me as if I've been pessimistic. I've been realistic because I said it. I actually called it back in March, the week that everything shut down. I actually sat my publisher down and I said, we need to have a game plan because there's a reality where we could not have any sports to cover for 6 months. And you know what? I was right.
Yeah,
I was right at the time.
Yeah.
So, I mean, again, I'm not saying I'm going to be right for this. I'm just saying, realistically, we need to prepare for that being a reality.
I really hope you're not, because I am in official denial of no NFL. I'll admit it. I just can't.
And again, trust me, as we were going to talk about.
Yeah, we will.
I have a reason.
Yes, you do.
Beyond work. Obviously, my job here at the radio station at the News Press revolves around sports.
Yeah.
So I need sports to come back. But yeah, I also, as of now, have second row tickets for the Chiefs home opener. I want sports to be happening because I want to be able to go to that.
So,
but
with that,
I don't know if I will.
The Sports Business Journal announced yesterday, Ben Fisher put it out, he's going to be on with us Monday, I believe. The story about, well, NFL teams, and you said today they officially did vote. It was expected.
NFL owners, according owners, to Adam Schefter, approved it.
Okay, it was expected to go through and officially did, I believe now, as you said, that they are planning on tarping off the first 6 to 8 rows in every stadium with advertisement on the tarps for local ads and all that.
Right, local. I think that's the big thing is Adam Schefter said local, so I'm assuming you're not going to be allowed to put big national brands on there.
Yeah, no, from what I read, so it would be like, I'm losing the name of it now, but the couple of names of supermarkets in Kansas City, I'm thinking of Hy-Vee and stuff like that.
Yeah, I think Hy-Vee is the sponsor.
Yeah.
They could probably be able to do something like that. Yeah, or like how OSU has, Game Day Ironworks and stuff like that around Game Day. Like, they could put something like that on there, but I don't think they could necessarily go out there and put a smack dab a Bud Light or something like that, I don't think.
Yeah, I'll have to go back to what I read in the Sports Business Journal, because I think there is a way that they're able to do a mixture of them, I believe, is what I read. But they definitely want it to be prominently local ads, I think, as well, which they're also talking about. I mean, the cost of these is going to be insane through the roof.
Yeah.
But the ones that can't afford are going to get some serious exposure.
Because I know the price of those two tickets that we've got for the second row are up there. They are up there. So I mean, there's a lot of money from fan seating if you were gonna have fans in the stands that you're losing out now by removing the first 6 to 8 rows. I will say, though, as much grief as we gave them over the years, Baylor was ahead of its time. They were tarping their stadium before there was a pandemic.
Yeah, that's very true. I love that, because Oakland has done the same thing in the NFL for a long time in their stadium. So here's what it said in the Sports Business Journal, that the team naming rights sponsors, local sponsors that don't conflict with league sponsors, and local sponsors would also have national deals. So like Bud Light, for instance.
Okay.
They would have the easiest time to get on there, but you would also get a chance for some local sponsors. So
they can't like contradict with that. So like for example, Kansas City probably couldn't have Boulevard Wheat beer on there because it would conflict with the Bud Light sponsorship that NFL owns.
Right. So there's, as he said, the restrictions are designed to protect the league sponsors already.
Okay.
So those naming rights, again, local sponsors that don't conflict with league sponsors. Okay. So, yeah, like Bud Light.
As long as there's not an official sponsor of the NFL.
Yes.
For whatever entity that you're in. Yeah. So, yeah.
The official sponsors we know, like, for instance, Microsoft on the tablets.
Right.
And Gatorade are the main two.
I believe Bud Light still is. Pizza Hut, I know, is now the official sponsor of the official pizza of the NFL and stuff
Pepsi
like that.
Was the drink, I think, all that stuff.
I'm assuming you wouldn't be able to put Joe Bob's Pizza shop next to the Pizza Hut.
I think
Hut
that's
place,
that's but, basically the gist of it.
But I'd be curious, like, for example, because I think, is it Kia, or is there's a brand of vehicle that's the official car dealer or car of the NFL.
Yeah.
If you would be allowed to still have a dealer's name, as long as it doesn't say, if let's say it's Kia normally that has the NFL deal, you don't have Joe Bob's Nissan.
Right, exactly. As long as maybe it just said Joe Bob's.
Right.
As long as it doesn't say.
I'm going to be curious about those entities, because, again, I mean, you see a lot of car dealerships willing to pay for those types of deals. So I'd be curious if they're going to be allowed to, because, I can't remember which company, but I believe there is a automobile company that has the quote naming rights for NFL.
Well, and think about it. I mean, when you watch an NFL game, it kind of made me think when they said you see Microsoft, you see Gatorade. I'm like, yeah, that's right. I mean, watching an NFL game, you don't see a lot of local sponsors unless they happen to flash up on the scoreboard or something else. That's it. So this, from a business standpoint, it makes sense. Will it make up money that you'd get from fans in the stands? No, but it would at least help. But I really am curious, like, for instance, in your situation, what are they going to do with those first 6 to 8 rows? Do they push those guys back and, like, knock other people out? Or do some people lose rights to tickets now all of a sudden? Because, like I told you, with every football field and every football team, it's going to be different based on location of how many fans they can have in stands.
As far as I know, the Chiefs have sold out. I'm assuming that home opener. And it's, if I have second row tickets,
where they put you?
Where they? I mean, even if you're saying we can go full capacity except for that those 6 to 8. Well, then what happens to the people who because, and then, you know, I'll say I have, you know, mine's an individual game, but I'm sure there's a lot of season ticket holders
that have those
that are in those first 6 to 8 rows. What are you going to do for them?
Oh, that's interesting. Let's go to the phone lines real quick here on the Afternoon Sports Drive.
Great stuff. Just a quick question. In my scenario, fans in the stands, until we get a vaccine, it's looking more and more unlikely you take South Texas, Houston. The ICUs are full. That's affecting everything in South Texas, maybe Austin, Baylor. If this scenario is true and fans are not allowed in the college game, not the pro, but in the college game, do they have the resources? Me being an Oklahoma State fan, would I get to see every Oklahoma State game live on TV? Do you have any idea how this would work out? Because I don't know that they have the resources to televise every college game that's played. Would it be tape delayed? Do you have any idea how that might work out? And I'll hang up and listen. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks for the phone call. Well, they put a lot of I'm not really sure what Oklahoma State has done consistently in the past in terms of how many games end up on like ESPN or whatever. Sometimes Fox does Big 12 games. If
I think it's still going to be the same as usual.
Yeah,
you're jockeying for spots.
Like the first one we know is going to be on ESPN, I believe, against Oregon State. That was what I heard.
So, yeah.
It's for the rest. It's kind of interesting because I think Iowa State had launched like their own little Iowa State TV, basically, is what it is, and MediaCom subscribers in that area get to watch every single game. So I don't really know the basis of Oklahoma State, like if they have a majority of their games ready to go, or conference games are going to be aired, I would assume.
Well, we got to keep in mind, when it comes to conference games, those are decided upon by the media outlets, you know, ABC, CBS, Fox, all those. Usually 2 weeks out. Sometimes they can ask for a window of 1 week. I'm assuming that will stand as is. And so you'll just kind of be up to the mercy. And I'm assuming I haven't seen anything for this upcoming season. But last year, at least one conference game was played on ESPN+. I'm assuming that will probably be the case again this upcoming year. But as far as I think the biggest one that the caller is probably concerned about will be some of your non-conference, your games that aren't against bigger opponents like Oregon State. I think it's ultimately going to come down to the mercy of who's willing to pick up those games.
Yeah, and
just
I don't,
as it has in the past.
I don't know how ESPN, for instance, and Fox, how comfortable they're going to end up being with sending camera crews and everybody to different locations. We've heard already that there's talk of possibly having a lot of broadcasters doing the games from a remote or a studio location.
Which they've already started doing with basketball recently.
Yeah.
So that
could definitely, you know, play a part in it as well.
Yeah, because it could be, because we saw that with the ESPN Plus game last year that OSU hosted. It was a case where Orange Power Studios basically did all the, you know, the broadcast essentially.
Right.
And that, you know, and I know a lot of people who watched it were not happy with it. There was a lack of cameras. It was one of the biggest complaints. And again, that, I mean, Orange Power can only do so much with what they have and how many people they have.
Yeah.
So, if you have more of those, that could be another issue. But again, as far as I would assume, nothing would change. As it would just be up to how the broadcast partners want to schedule.
And maybe, you know, ESPN ultimately is able to form some type of ESPN Plus deal where they stream a lot more games than they would originally. But what that would force people to do is to buy an ESPN Plus subscription. Right. It's not a free service. So, yeah, it's going to be something we'll keep an eye on and try to figure out as well, because that is a great question. When we come back, Tom Dorado joins us now, number two. That's next.
Like my futuristic sounds in the new spaceship. Futuristic in the Philip K. She never need a man, she what a man need. So I keep on falling for her daily. We was at Coachella going crazy. Stack a couple M's like I was Shady. Now I'm in Tribeca like I'm Jay-Z. Rockin' store, I am, I like you pay me. I just signed a new deal with Mercedes. Got me moving dirty like I'm Swayze. All my diamonds dancing like they Swayze.
Welcome back to the Afternoon Sports Drive, hour number two. Like they Swayze. Here on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network, Patrick Wheeler and Tommy D is joining us. Tom Dorado taking Jason's spot. Jason has to go get his car.
Oh, I couldn't. I never take his spot.
Oh, well, you subbed him out. You tapped his shoulder and subbed him out. So
I mean,
I hit the buzzer and you're in.
I'm just trying to maintain till he gets back on the court again.
Oh, okay. All right. Well, whichever way you want to put it. Tommy D's going to have. We're going to have Donnie Walton on at 4:30. Is that,
right,
is that still the plan?
420.
Oh, 420?
Yes,
perfect.
Sir.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. We'll get this segment going and get him on.
Yeah, we'll have a good time. We're going to talk baseball.
Yeah, that's
I'm kind of interested in what his status is.
I am too, because his – is he going – that's what I want to know. Is he going to have a chance to make this this taxi squad?
Well, I'm going to assume, and maybe he's going to tell me don't assume.
Yeah.
But I don't know what his status is. Are you going back to spring training?
Yeah, where's he?
To be part of the taxi squad? Because he was one of the last cuts being made in spring training one that was sent to Tacoma. And so I think everybody assumed that there were he and those other two guys were being sent to Tacoma for the an immediate call-up. Whoever needs to be called up first, they're coming.
So you think he'd be right on the list, right, for some of those that would have maybe a shot?
Yeah, but is he now competing for the 40-man roster again?
Yeah, that's right.
Or is he competing to stay on the 20-man roster for a taxi squad? I don't know. I mean, only he can give me that. I know as competitive as he is, he's not going to – he's going there to make the 40-man roster. That's what he did in spring training one. But I wonder in this case if a lot of those spots are already determined because of the COVID and who's coming back, if any spots will open up. I guess what I'm going to ask him is how much real competition is going to be in this next spring training, or is it just running the outfield and trying to get back in shape again?
Right. We'll get all of that and much more from him up in probably about 10 minutes or so. Let's talk first, and then Tommy D coming in with me here now. Let's talk this NASCAR situation again as continues to develop. I mean, we get the FBI statement, the NASCAR statement about Bubba Wallace's situation where a noose was found in his garage that was now determined to be a pull-down rope for the garage door. Been up there since October of 2019. Well, the photo finally gets released today. And here's the thing. Like, I look at the photo and, yeah, I mean, it resembles a noose. I mean, I'm not gonna say that it doesn't. But does it necessarily mean what a lot of people initially thought? I don't think that was ever the case, and I said that yesterday, and I still stand by that. The NASCAR president comes out and says that when he gave his original statement, they should have used the word alleged in the statement. Yeah, I mean, that to me is the issue, okay? That's a no-brainer, is that even if you thought one way or the other, the right thing to do, and it's, you know, hindsight's 20/20 for these guys, but the right thing to do is say allegedly there was a noose hanging. That clears you from picking a side, because NASCAR shouldn't have taken a side. I mean, they want to support their drivers, but until they know everything, it makes no sense, because if it happened to be not the situation you thought it was, then this comes around, you look foolish to a lot of people.
Well, I think in this highly charged atmosphere that we're living in right now, I could see why they would have reacted that way. Because initially, the shock that this was a noose in the garage of a black man who had a lot to do with getting rid of the Confederate flag and NASCAR, you had a lot of moving parts to this thing. And as it turned out, the head of NASCAR probably came out and as you said, should have said alleged, because it didn't turn out to be like everybody thought it was, or at least it looked that way. Then they had the show of support, pushing his car up front and all the drivers and all that stuff, which I guess is good. I was talking to you before. My interest now has shifted a little bit to who had that garage in 2019.
Yeah, which according to NASCAR, they are unable to determine that, is what
really?
They say. They know that it's been there since that long, but they're unable to determine who was there.
Well, if they knew it was there, then I guess it did not alarm them like it did this time around.
That's my thing, is that They kind of said, well, whoever it was, you know, saw it and most likely never thought of it in a negative fashion, which Yeah, I mean, if you're a NASCAR driver and let's say you've used this before, that's why I'm actually curious. Like, have you ever used a rope like this, like tied it like that to pull something down?
I've
personally
pulled down rope in my with my garage.
But is it tied like that?
No, no. I mean, you could tie it that way. No.
Would it make sense to tie like that to grab like the handle?
Well, it
and
would
pull
make
it down?
Sense to have a loop where you could reach
right,
that.
Right,
and,
exactly.
Because it's, you know, it's a little awkward sometimes, and it's there to disengage your to make it more manual.
Yeah.
If the electricity went off, then you could not hit the buzzer and your automatic garage door goes up. So you could disengage the garage door with this pull down, and then you could do it manually.
That's my thing is, if it's been there for since 2019.
And nobody's voiced the...
Nobody was concerned about it before. And then you're also telling... I mean, I have to assume that there were NASCAR or at least Talladega personnel that had walked through those garages before Bubba Watson got the garage and saw it and never thought a thing about it, right? And that's why it bothers me that people are like, dude, you don't realize the height of the... I get it. We're in a state of unrest and everything. But that, to me, does not excuse people from thinking without emotion and coming out with statements before facts are revealed, because that's exactly what NASCAR did. NASCAR didn't need to release a statement about that situation. And my other problem with it here is, why did this take so long to come to a conclusion? They brought in 15 FBI agents.
That's almost unbelievable.
15 FBI agents for this. Set everybody down, and it took them, what, like 3 days to figure this out? This should have been like an hour investigation at most. And so to me, it's drawn out. And my other thing, I've looked really detailed into this. So when I see this picture, and don't we all know, like a noose, when you pull on it, it's designed to tighten, right?
Correct.
So if you put your hand in the loop to pull down, and if it were a noose, would it not tighten around your hand every single time, and you'd have to loosen your hand? Wouldn't that just be a waste of time to do all that?
Well,
I mean, you see what I'm getting at?
Yeah, I mean, I never thought of the X's and O's of a loop.
That's
how
deep I've looked at it.
But I do think, at least in this highly charged atmosphere we're in, the narrative just jumped off the page that here we have a black driver who we're trying to support, and now maybe somebody has scuttled that support by putting a noose in his garage. And then there was the other side of the coin that was saying, well, you know, maybe he and his people are trying to further their stance by just creating it and putting it there themselves. I mean, you had both ends of the spectrum, but nowhere in the middle did anybody come up with, well, you know, it might not have been somebody who put it in there.
Yeah, and I don't think it was, like, planted or anything like that. I think it was a huge misunderstanding. But nonetheless, it could have been handled a lot better from every angle.
Have we said that on another occasion?
Oh man.
Could have been handled better.
Yeah. I mean, but isn't that the thing that we consistently have to repeat that point? This could have been handled better and really should have been. Like, there's so many times where stuff like this happens where it's like, this is inexcusable, okay? If I'm sitting here and can tell you what should have happened, those guys should have been
ESPN
able to figure it out.
And ESPN fanned the flames with it when they had that report.
No kidding.
Jumping to the conclusion
absolutely.
That this was yet another indication of racial injustice.
And that right there to me, that I think drove some people from that brand, finally. It's like, you didn't even give it a chance to breathe.
Well,
you know
that's the kind of the society we live
it
in
is,
right now.
It is, and it's unfortunate.
And they, you know, definitely egg on NASCAR's face.
Yeah. Everywhere.
But again, I would be interested in somebody coming up. Maybe call my brother and I'll see maybe he can
We need to get him back on now.
Who had that garage? I mean, is that hard to figure out? Who had the garage in 2019?
I can't believe it is. I really can't.
And who was in there? And why would they have done that?
Yeah.
Could we not question them?
That's where we are now with all this. Go to the phone lines. You're on the Afternoon Sports Drive. Go ahead.
Hey guys, I don't know if either one of you ever watched those YouTube clips with the Hodges twins, but they've got one on the Bubba thing, and I mean all that stuff is pretty hilarious that they put out, but it's also pretty factual about all the stuff going through. But anyway, that's just something you, if you have spare time and want a lighthearted moment and kind of mixed in with the seriousness of it, they follow those guys. They're a hoot.
Okay. You said the Hodges brothers on YouTube?
Hodges twins.
Hodges twins. Okay. Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay.
Two black guys, but they're really cool.
Okay. Well, hey, thanks. I'll have to check it out. Yeah, sure. That's kind of the thing, is that there's been plenty of takes about this. And I think that people that also had the egg on their face are the ones that came out, not just on ESPN, but everywhere else, and were like, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
The first thought is that this is some type of racial thing. Like,
well, let's bring it back here. Hubbard's tweet, he kind of left it hanging. And people jump to the conclusion a black student athlete is tweeting this, so thus there must be a racial problem in the football program at Oklahoma State. I don't know if there was and wasn't. Obviously, there was some things that people didn't like. I don't know if we're going to go that far and say it's a racial problem. Communications problem probably is the same, is more precise. But at the same time, that tweet leaves the narrative around the country that this African-American Heisman Trophy winner doesn't like how he's being treated at Oklahoma State. Thus, in this highly charged situation, people jump, you know, one and one makes five this time, and it becomes a racial problem. That's kind of where we live right now, and we're still putting up with that in terms of national perception. I don't know that, here in Stillwater, Oklahoma, you're going to have a lot more of an inside look, and maybe you don't see it that way, but I have no problem with people who are trying to make a judgment nationally, because let's stop and think about this. If this was happening at the University of Texas, okay, and they've got their own problems, obviously, too, with not having the eyes of Texas, but you think the fan base at Oklahoma State wouldn't be just riveted to one story after another about the racist approach going on at Texas, even if it wasn't that?
Mm.
So you have to kind of step back and see how it's being interpreted here. And that's the downside of the highly charged situation we're in. And I know this inclusion committee, diversity committee, that has been put together, not a surprise at all. It will be, as it was put out, it'll be part of the Oklahoma State Athletic Department from here on out.
Yep.
And as I mentioned to you, the thing I want to do is this. I want to make sure that everybody goes into this with their eyes open. The committee gets together, and this is what they're going to do. This is what they're going to say. And we're not in the athletic department, so we're not going to run the we're going to give you our interpretation of what we see and our recommendations. And in the athletic department, you got to be receptive to what you hear. Again, I've been on the other side of these committees, but it was on a probation situation where we had people who were put together from various corners of the university, and somehow they didn't come in with that same overview. Yeah. You know, they came in thinking they were going to call the shots, and I don't want to create a divide there, but it has to be a mutual agreement, if you will. This committee is going to take a look at what they see. Maybe we can make these improvements. We're suggesting this. The athletic department has to be receptive to the suggestions. But it can't be, in my opinion, this is me speaking, but it can't be a committee of people coming in and going into Holder's office and saying, here's 20 things you better change by Monday.
Yeah.
I don't think that would work.
I don't either. And I think we all would agree that that's going to be a hard sell. I mean, for that to happen. Will it cause positive discussion? Hopefully. I think that's the main reason that it was formed, and hopefully it does. With Donnie Walton here in a second, I'll wrap up the Bubba Wallace thing with this. I see so many different things involving him being on The View, on CNN. He's making his publicity rounds now. And then he came out, he's like, I didn't want all this. I didn't want this attention, all this stuff. I'm like, dude, Bubba, you did want all this. Like, you made sure that was the case with the Confederate flag. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm saying he wanted the attention. Like, let's be honest. So let's not act like that's part of it, or not part of it. And then with Bubba here as well, and all of this going on, I get people that all of a sudden now it's this argument of whether it was even a noose or not. I'm like, that's not the thing. Like, the FBI said that it is a pull down rope, fashioned like a noose, like it is designed to pull down a garage door. It is designed to pull down a garage door.
Yeah, and you know, the narratives that just keep coming up, it would be an easy narrative to accept, right? And
that's why so many do.
But I'm with you to the extent that an investigation, I mean, nobody should have said anything from the NASCAR perspective until the investigation was over.
At least onto that level.
Yeah.
Like, they can come out and put a little...
Say, this doesn't look good.
Yeah.
This is, we don't put up with this, blah, blah, blah.
Which is fine.
But you can't come down with the guilt right away.
Yeah, and if for any reason, it's for this situation.
Yeah.
Because when this does happen... Because this has happened before plenty of times, and it's involved race, okay? It has. Michael Bennett did the same thing in the NFL.
Yeah.
When he came out and said, hey, I was attacked by cops in Vegas,
mm-hmm.
and then video surfaced, and that was 100% untrue, and debunked it. Well, then it just disappeared, though.
But in today's society, as we face it right now, that's the quickest narrative that people jump to.
Yeah, and that's not... If you are a journalist or part of the media, and your job is to report fairly, or at least that's what it's supposed to be, then there needs to be more that take that approach of, let's wait,
mm-hmm.
let's get the facts. We know that even if we reported something that we just want to believe happened, we might get more clicks. But oh my goodness, if we report facts, we might get more justification here as a publication. I mean, ESPN has driven themselves into a hole with this type of thing, running with stories like this without waiting. And they're not the only ones, but they're the main ones. And they force organizations like NASCAR to have to come out and say something that was premature. And it was.
But they certainly were in a... Not an enviable position.
No, they
at
weren't.
All
they
because
weren't. And I agree that you say that. But again, to me, you're a giant sports organization that pays lots of money for PR teams to be able to handle situations. And when you fail like this, that's really unexcusable.
Yeah, it's an egg on your face for sure. But I guess the bright side of this is, at least as we know it now, nobody put that noose in there because of Bubba Wallace.
Yeah, the positive is it wasn't a hate crime. Yeah,
okay.
The positive is we're not dealing with a hate crime.
Now, how it got there and why it got there, I'd be interested as they trace. Surely they know who's been in the garage over the last couple of years, right? That they could figure something out.
I mean,
there.
I would think it's possible. That's why it kind of blew my mind whenever we talked about, well, why are we not able to look at video and photos to see who did this? I mean, really, because it's a NASCAR garage at Talladega.
Because in 2019.
Yeah.
We didn't have the security. Now, the pits, yeah, as Chris probably would have told you, not every Tom, Dick, and Harry can just walk down in the garage area, but I would think there were a lot more people in that garage area in 2019 than are allowed in there right now because of the virus.
And that's kind of what NASCAR said. There were people that went through there, and no one thought anything of it.
Yeah. I mean, somebody would have voiced something. But, you know, I do think it's another example of how we have to approach trying to do the right thing and not getting carried away. And I want to go back to this diversity and inclusion committee again. I think this has every chance to being a positive for not only the football program, but for the entire athletic department. Because keep in mind, I don't think Kirksey and his committee are going to just focus on football. I mean, this is a total look at the athletic department. And if the committee foresees something that is not going very well in another area, they're going to voice their concern. But my concern is, and it's just an observation, because I've been through committees not like this, but committees before, it's the overall, what am I trying to say? The overall approach that a committee takes when coming in and looking at a department. And I don't care what it is, athletics. If they came up with a committee to overlook the engineering school, now the people in the engineering school would say, now, you know, okay, let's work together. But they would probably resent if I was on a committee and I knew nothing about it, and I come in and all of a sudden in the first week I got 10 things that you need to change. In order for this to work, while things have to be raised and questions have to be raised, there has to be reception on the other end. Okay. We didn't know that. We didn't see it that way. So maybe we need to see your way and get it changed. What I'm saying in short, Patrick, we don't need to have more division created by a committee.
Yeah, no,
And believe me, I'm not saying Kirksey's going to do that, because he's in this business and he understands the total picture from a university perspective.
And
he
understands
that.
For it.
Sure.
Yeah.
So he understands what I'm saying. But the worst thing that could happen is to be perceived in the athletic department that, until we brought this committee in, you guys were working in the wrong direction. And that, to me, this is just me personally, that doesn't work. It has to be a feeling of cooperation, yep, if you will.
I'd also be fairly curious if this committee had been formed before, would Chuba Hubbard have gone to this committee over this issue instead of Twitter? I mean, who knows? Honestly, it definitely could have helped things, which I think it will before it's all said and done. We'll hit our break. We'll come back and have Donnie Walton. That's next. Welcome back to the Afternoon Sports Drive, Triple Play Sports Radio Network. Patrick Wheeler and Tom Dorado with you here, 1580 AM, 1020 AM, 93.1 FM and 105.1 FM, and the Triple Play Sports Radio app. And joining us now, as promised, Donnie Walton, the Seattle Mariners organization.
Donnie and I are trying to come up with answers, and every time we come up with another question. But
that's easy.
But I guess let's start on the positive, Donnie, that, okay, baseball is going to be played on a major league level, so that's a positive. And you're going to be headed up to Seattle to join the big club in Seattle for spring training part two, I guess. So that's a positive. But what about the doubt as to where this is all going to shake out for somebody like yourself?
Yeah, to be honest, I think just everybody's excited that baseball's back. And then we're going to play somewhat of a season. I think everybody was, tired of waiting and hearing what's going to happen. And we're all just ready to go play and be back with the team again. Kind of just looking ahead, I really don't know what their plan is for me, but I know they asked me to come along, and I'm leaving Sunday, and probably get more information as I get there. But I think everybody's just excited that baseball's back.
You know, that was the question I had of you, because you were in spring training part one. You were out there competing as hard as you could to make the big squad, the 40-man squad, and you were one of the last guys that was sent to Tacoma, had everything stayed the same before the rug was pulled out from everything. But so you're going up there with the idea, is it a 30-30 thing? Tell me about it. 30 on the big club, 30 on the taxi squad. How do you understand it?
Yeah, that's what I'm hearing. I don't know if that's the final say, but I think it's going to be 30 guys that are suited up, and the other 30 guys are going to be guys staying ready and called the taxi squad, and just, we'll probably be scrimmaging against each other, taking live at bats, kind of like how college is in the fall. We'll just be inter-squatting and just staying ready for if anything happens. That's what it looks like right now.
How about the idea that you'll be doing this in your home park, and that eventually maybe some guys might be sent to Tacoma? You said Everett, maybe. To stay sharp or whatever on the taxi squad, but it has to be crazy to think you're going to walk into your home park and there'll be nobody there, and maybe three times this week you're going to scrimmage each other.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be different. Definitely going to be different, but with everything going on, the pandemic happening, I think everybody just wants to start playing again, and it's going to be unusual at first, but hopefully towards the end of the season, they start putting people in the stands, hopefully. But it's gonna be a little different. It's gonna probably take us all back to college and inter-squad in the fall like we did back in college.
How did you stay sharp as possible during this downtime? I mean, being over in Tulsa, I mean, you got Cobb over there, you got yourself. I'm probably missing some other body. Were you able to get together and at least see some live pitching?
Yeah. So I've been trying to just treat each day like it was in spring training. We had a routine each day, pretty much is the go play catch, take ground balls, take BP, and then get a little bit of lunch. And if you had a lift that day, go lift. And so I'm pretty much doing that during the week to stay ready, and been able to see Cobb and Battenfield. They've been throwing me live pretty much once a week. So I've been able to stay ready for sure, and been really fortunate. If we play tomorrow, I'd be ready to go.
Donnie, Patrick Wheeler here. One of the changes that I think is pretty interesting coming in with the season is the fact that teams will only be playing teams within their division, and then the other ones will be interleague opponents kind of in the same geographical area. For instance, AL West plays NL West. Since you've been up in the pros before, how would that change the approach of a pro club like the Mariners coming in, knowing that, well, we kind of know who our opponents are because they're kind of limited in a sense?
Yeah, you're gonna see the same arms a lot, and you know, as an offensive player, you like that because the more you see a guy, the more comfortable you get. But yeah, it's like I said, it's gonna be different. I say it's gonna look like more of a minor league season where there's not as many teams you're playing seven other teams. Like we did in the Texas League, so you get to see a lot of the same guys throughout the year. But you know, I, like I said, it's going to be interesting, and I think everybody has an idea, especially from going from last year. You know how teams look and what their rotation looks like. So it should be fun.
You know, you've been around baseball your whole life, so probably some of this doesn't shock you as maybe we might think it would, but when you look at some of the things that you guys are going to have to go through, it, you mean, you're going to be tested like every time you turn around. You have temperature checks. When you finally get to the park, you know, you're not going to hang around a clubhouse. You're not going to all sit in the dugout, not take any showers there. You're going to have to live in a different area. Some way it goes back to maybe high school stuff when you got on the bus and came over to Coweta to play when I remember you there. But overall, no people in the stands. I mean, you can't. Now, you're not, you know, tobacco spitter. But I mean, no spitting up gum. And you got all kinds of stuff that is second nature to baseball players that won't be second nature now.
Yeah, it's I think that's what everybody's kind of worried about going in is, you know, what's allowed and what's not allowed. And because guys have routines and, you know, some guys want to shower before the game. Some guys, you know, have all their superstitions and stuff like that. And it's going to be a little bit different. And at first, I don't think it's going to feel like baseball because you're so worried about what you can do and what you can't do, but I think everybody will get used to it after a couple weeks. I think the testing we'll get in a better routine as it goes. But yeah, as soon as I get there, I think Monday I have a test, and then I'm have to stay in the hotel for a couple days, and then our first meeting is the first, and then the first team practice is the third. So you know, it's going to take some time to get used to, but I think anybody's, you know, will do anything to have baseball back again.
Are you concerned personally about this health situation that, you know, you could do everything right and still get it and still test positive? And I still want to know how in the world they're going to get around the I've said this from day one. I mean, unless you change things around, you got a batter, you got a catcher, and you got an umpire. That's close proximity, three different people. But are you concerned personally that I could do everything and it still might not work?
You know, it's, I haven't gave it much thought, and since I've been here, I haven't gave it much thought, but I know if the one thing is if you're smart, and you're able to take care of yourself, take care of your body, then I don't think you have much to worry about. But I think overall, if you're smart of where you're going and you know, watching what you touch and, you know, making sure you wash your hands, I think everything will take care of itself. But most of all, just kind of being smart and being aware of where you're at.
Donnie Walton joined us here on the Afternoon Sports Drive in the Seattle Mariners organization. Donnie, you talked about all those little things that baseball players do. I mean, they've gotten pretty detailed. I think it was like 100 pages worth of new rules and everything that's going to be in Major League Baseball. You know, no licking the fingers, no sunflower seeds, tobacco, spitting, whatever, all that stuff. How much, though, if you're being completely honest, do you expect that to be fully enforced? Because, I mean, you got a lot of players out there at the same time and in the dugout and all that. I mean, is this really going to be something that, oh, my gosh, we caught this guy spitting over there, or we caught this guy chewing sunflower seeds? And I mean, is that going to be seriously enforced?
Yeah, you know, I'm very interested to see. That's kind of what I've been wondering about. I think I'll get more information about it once I get there because, you know, it's all part of baseball, but I get why they want us to do it. But I think it's a conversation that the teams and the MLB are going to have once we all get there and once games start getting back up and practicing and teams are out there on the field. So I'm interested to see if that's all going to be, you know, serious, or is it something that they just prefer guys to do?
Well, if they throw out as many balls as they do now when the ball hits the dirt and they throw it out of play, and they're going to throw out balls that are touched by more than one person, we're going to be playing there for a while. They better bring a whole lot of supply of baseballs. But let me ask you, how forthcoming has the Mariner organization been? And I don't mean they call you every night. I'm not getting that. But how forthcoming have they been about what to expect now that we're back in business, so to speak?
You know, since it's kind of just started back up and we all just got the news a couple days ago, I think they're all just trying to get information and, you know, when we're flying out, how we're getting there. I think they're all just worried about that right now. But, you know, through this time, during the pandemic, you know, they try to keep in touch, and they've done a great job just, you know, calling us and seeing how we're doing and how's our body and is everybody healthy, or if you have any symptoms, let us know. And so they've definitely stayed in touch and made sure that we're doing all right. And now it's just trying to get everybody there and get everybody there and safe and healthy you know, hopefully everybody's gotten tested and there's all negative, and we get there out in the field and try to act like, you know, there's no pandemic and go out there and play ball.
A couple of things before we cut you loose that I want to get your comment. Number one, Polkovich was drafted by the Mariners. You know, he has a little bit of a copy that he could file. You see what Donnie Walton did. Everybody's different. I don't know if you talked to him. And what about this Texas Collegiate League that's going on now, starting up here next week? About five guys from Oklahoma State are going to be on that. Tom Holliday is going to be the manager. He's going to be at One Oak and all that. What kind of a deal is that? Now, you being in Tulsa, maybe that's not as big a deal because you've been around that park, but that's a big deal for these kids.
Yeah. You know, once I heard it, I think I thought it was a great idea, and I know guys are bored out of their minds and they want to play ball and try to you know, still grind things out and try to find a way to get better. And you know, more games you play, the better you're going to get. So I think it's a great idea and very exciting for college kids to get back there on the field and start competing again. And you know, when Cade got Polkovich got drafted, you know, Mariners have called me and all my pops about him before the draft. So mm-hmm. We had a pretty good idea that Mariners were going to take him. So when it happened, it was just super cool that another Cowboy is going to be a Mariner. And just by just getting to know Polkovich just a little bit while he was here, he really loves the game. He loves to compete, and you got to have those guys in your organization because you know what you're going to get. So just super happy for him.
Hey, we appreciate your time. I know this is busy as you're trying to get everything ready to head on out back to Seattle. I'll keep in touch with you as we go along because I want to see how you're adapting to all this new style of baseball. But once again, best of luck to you, and we'll talk soon.
Awesome. Thank you. Thank you guys for having me.
All right, buddy. See ya. That's Donnie Walton, who's, I would imagine, Patrick, he feels good, but he's probably got a lot of questions he wants answered
as
well.
Oh, yeah, he has, just like we do.
And and he's right in the middle of it. So, I mean, I feel confident for him.
Yeah.
Because he was right there on the cusp in spring training one, if you will. So, they haven't forgotten that he could play. They haven't forgotten that he played 16 games, I think, last year or something.
I think that's
something
right.
To that effect.
Yeah.
At the end of the year or close to that and acquitted himself well so he could play in the big leagues. So I feel confident that he will be part of whatever the package is, 30 for 30, 30 and 30, 40 and 20, whatever it is, mm-hmm. that he'll be on the club. But, boy, I'll be interested in touching base with him in about 3 or 4 weeks.
Yeah.
See, how's all this stuff going on?
Yeah. July 1st is right around the corner. So then we're getting really close to having some form of baseball. When we come back, I don't know if you heard yet, Tom Dorado, but the Eddie film has a date and time.
No, I have not.
All right. We'll discuss that next.
Levitating off the blacktop. Used to struggle getting started, now I can't stop. Used to be the quiet kid in the sandbox. Now it's hands up every time that your man rocks. They ought to stop me coming in again. You mad? You thought we were synonyms? Too bad, that's the water you're getting in. You're too fat for the sharks that you're swimming in. From where I'm sitting, contenders are looking like fruit spinning around in a blender. Hardly a snack when I'm here looking for dinner. I eat them, delete them, they're barely beginners. Main course is my main sport. Play major, but minor's my main fort. Put a chain around everything I came for. Look, but don't judge, sucker, tell them take an IOU. Say they want respect now, thinking they deserve to have it next now. Tell them take an IOU. Believing what they're making up, talking loud but never really saying.
Welcome
much.
Back,
tell
wrapping up the afternoon.
Oh, I'm gonna have to go over a list of songs. I'm gonna get you. I'm gonna get you converted.
You like Def Leppard? I put them on before.
I've had them on occasion. No, we don't play them as much, but yeah.
Well, I put them on before this song, and you didn't say anything. Well, of course, you were on the phone with Donnie,
yeah,
so.
I didn't hear it. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I need to pay
more
attention.
Selective hearing over there for
that's
Tommy
true.
D.
That is true.
Hey, it feels like a long time coming since we've been talking about the Eddie film, but
yes.
Finally. We have a date and a time for the premiere.
Lay it on me.
On ESPN2, so everybody can watch.
ESPN. Big
ESPN. Monday night, okay. This upcoming Monday, the 29th at 8 p.m. Central Time. So our time here, 8 p.m. And then the Finding Big Country film will also be playing July 1st at 6 p.m.
Okay.
So you got two heavy doses of Oklahoma State there.
I was telling you during the break, and I know I've said it at least once, I would encourage our fans on Monday the 29th at 8 o'clock Central Time, ESPN, to DVR the Eddie film.
Yep, I echo that.
Because it is such a fast-paced, high-low, even, high-low, lots of action, lots of people, that... if you didn't DVR it and go back again and watch it again, the second time will be the most complete watching for you in my mind because it is so fast-paced and it goes from so many things, starting back when he was a young kid in Buckland, Kansas, all the way to his induction. There's so many elements to it that if you don't DVR it, you're going to get lost probably in two or three of the changes. And you're going to say, oh, man, I wish I had – I didn't remember him saying it. Just DVR it. Go back and watch it again, and you can watch – now you know what's going to happen, but you can watch it with a little bit more conviction.
Yeah.
I mean, you'll be able to watch and listen a lot more closely to what was said, who said it, how they said it, what they were saying. That would be my suggestion to you. DVR it, because you'd have it, you know, to play forever and play for your friends
exactly.
and whatever. So.
And definitely check out the Eddie Sutton Film Twitter page that Chris Hunt runs, because he put out a trailer as well, 30 seconds long. That's a quick play video. I mean, it's that 30 seconds will give you chills. If you haven't seen it, it's deep, man. And you've told me before, this is it's a roller coaster of emotions.
It will be an emotional roller coaster ride
for
the viewers.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I don't want to spoil anything, so be prepared to take that ride with actually the Sutton family.
Yeah. This will be I can't wait, because, you know, come Tuesday, you might have to sneak on early next week, because we're going to have to break that down.
Yes, sir.
I know you've already seen it, but we're going to break it down on the premiere.
Well, it's an emotional 90 minutes. I think it's close to 90 if it's
I think that's
90.
Right. Yep.
And it's emotional, and it will tug at you if you're a close basketball fan, if you followed Eddie Sutton every step of the way, or you're just a casual fan looking at this story. It is a classic story of highs and lows, accomplishments, failures, the roller coaster takes you for 90 minutes, and you will be amazed at some of the things you hear right from the heart, from the people who talk. And as I said before, without spoiling it, yes, Rex Chapman had a big role in it, and sometimes what he said was you kind of look back a little bit. But in my mind, Sean was, you know, Eddie was obviously one, but Sean was 1A in this thing.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Sean had a lot of heartfelt things to say. So be ready I don't know if you're just going to cry from start to finish, but be ready. You may have a tear before it's over.
Again, that's Monday, June 29th, 4 days from now, 8 p.m. And make sure you do not miss it. It'll be available, I believe, for 3 months on ESPN platforms where you can stream it afterwards. But if you DVR, you can have it for as long as you want. So definitely be able to check that out at some point. Tomorrow, Tyler Sullivan writes for CBS Sports covers the NFL. He'll be on with us. A lot of stuff going on in the National Football League, including putting tarps over some seats to put advertisement. And we talked about that.
No,
it just so happens
really?
that Jason's second row tickets are going to be covered up, it looks like, in Kansas City.
Well, they're going to make a buck somehow.
Well,
right?
Yeah, but yeah. What's going to happen to those guys like Jason? That's what I want to know next, and I'm hoping Tyler can hopefully fill us in on that.
They don't know. They're messing with Jason Elmquist.
That's right, and his Chief tickets. Oh, my
they
goodness.
They don't know what they're getting into here.
Yeah, we mentioned some teams have already practiced this for a long time, like Baylor and college football, and the Raiders in pro football have covered up seats for quite a while now. So, you know, they won't have any problem with it. But teams like the Chiefs and that sell out consistently, that's going to be
You know what? You got to find a way to make a buck.
That's right. Yeah, so he'll be on with us tomorrow. That's Tom Dorado. Big thank you to him for coming in, as always. Big thank you to Donnie Walton there at 4:30. We'll get that interview posted up for everyone, too, in case you missed it. Jason Elmquist earlier. I'm Patrick Wheeler. We'll be back here tomorrow, same place, same time, to wrap up the week. This has been the Afternoon Sports Drive on the Triple Play Sports Radio Network.